Good morning. I'm Alice Rivlin, and I'm the director of the Engelberg Center for Healthcare Reform at the Brookings Institution. And I'm delighted to welcome you, both the audience right here in this room and the audience that is joining us on the webcast. I'm delighted to welcome you to the third in our series of MEDTalks, this one on pediatric asthma. And I'm welcoming you not only on behalf of Brookings, but on behalf of the Dr. Richard Merkin Initiative on Payment Reform and Clinical Leadership. This is a program that we are very glad to be participating in. Dr. Merkin, because he is himself a clinician, is very interested in payment reform. How can we change the way we reward providers to improve the results, both on improving care and outcomes for patients and on reducing waste? So we're going to talk about pediatric asthma this morning. Pediatric asthma, well, asthma in general, but especially for children, is a scary disease. I remember as an asthmatic child, the fear, the I can't breathe feeling. And my asthma, fortunately, was short-lived. I outgrew it. My sister didn't, and most of my memories of pediatric crises, asthma crises are associated with her. That was many years ago. Treatment has improved. Doctors know a lot more about what to do, and not all of the interventions are medical. There are better medications, but we've also learned a lot about other things to do to prevent the crises that so often end in an emergency room. We're going to start this morning with some stories to get everybody engaged in what it's like to have asthma, what it's like to treat asthma, and be really part of the experience. So this is what we call a TED style or med style format, and we will hear from patients, we will hear from doctors, we will hear from others to try to get an understanding of how payment reform can make it better for these scared kids and their parents and everybody else. So I am delighted to turn it over to a real doctor, Dr. Kavita Patel, who will take us to the next step.
All right. Thank you, Alice. And in that TED-style feeling, I don't have the security blanket of like a podium or anything else to like stand behind and hide something. So I just want to be brief. I wanted to thank everyone for coming and not only echo Alice's comments, but do a little bit of a setup. So part of this series is not only telling stories, and I spend the majority of my time here as a scholar at Brookings working on payment reform and clinical transformation, but also spend part of my time as a primary care doctor in the DC area. So taking care, I actually had earlier this week an adult asthmatic who's had asthma since she was a child, who kept calling for refills, and we had to deal with kind of the denial of filling in her prescriptions, which have been tailored to prevent her from having to go to an emergency room during an asthma flare. And I had to get into a very unfortunate set of conversations with her pharmacy benefit management company, who was kind of acting on behalf of the insurance company. And I actually timed it on my iPhone, and it took me 37 minutes. And those were 37 minutes that are important for that particular patient, but 37 minutes where if I were a full-time clinician, I would not have that luxury within my schedule. When I'm seeing patients, I see 32 people in one day, one every 15 minutes. and I never have a break really other than 30 minutes for lunch, which I use to catch up on charts. So I'm bringing this from a practical perspective because when we talk about concepts like payment reform, they seem like 20,000 foot ideas to most people who are actually inside or around the healthcare system, including patients, their families, as well as the voice of all the multitude of providers. And I happen to be a physician, but the same could be said for my medical assistant, who works very closely with me and is actually the person who probably spends the most time interacting with patients and their families when they have problems. One of the things we talk about in clinical medicine, for how many of you are in the clinical area, have kind of a clinical background? Okay, so a good chunk of you. So you'll all appreciate this. In medicine, we say that when you hear hoofbeats, think horses, not zebras. And that really just speaks to the fact that as clinicians, we're trained to look for some of the most kind of complex, we were trained to think about what's called the differential diagnosis, things that are very complex, might even be rare, because if you don't think about it, then it's not in your mind for a diagnosis. However, the majority of people have something very common like asthma. I try to take that to the next level to think about payment reform, which most of my physician friends kind of don't understand, eyes glaze over. And I try to say, when you think about something as complex as payment reform, you know, think of horses, not zebras. What are the very things, those 37 minutes that you spend, that you really should be doing something else that might be of higher value? And how can we change the system? Why is it that when insurance companies or pharmaceutical companies need to engage with us, we go through faxes and kind of arcane phone calls? Why can't we have a better way of streamlining how we coordinate our care? And that's for not just asthma, which we're going to talk about today, but it's for all conditions. So when we think about concepts of payment reform, it's how can we think about building blocks based on our practical experiences and apply them to something that does seem like something so rare, such as payment reform. And the truth is that the time is now. I think the Merkin Initiative has offered us an opportunity to have a dialogue in a place like Brookings, in a city like Washington, and translate it to people watching on a webcast. There are hundreds of people watching right now all across the country who are looking for these types of solutions. So I think that as you're listening to the speakers today, I think you'll have a better appreciation of how to approach a problem from the perspective of horses, not zebras. So that's what I want to leave you with. With that, I want to introduce Dr. Steve Farmer, who is the clinical lead on this MedTalk series. He's an associate professor of medicine and public health at the George Washington University, a clinical cardiologist, as well as an esteemed health services researcher, and will actually help us kick off as the MC. So thank you.
Welcome. Welcome, everyone, to our MedTalk today. I'm delighted to welcome you. And to those of you who are watching on the web, we'd like to extend a welcome to you as well. We'll have an extended question and answer session after the talk where you'll have an opportunity to ask questions directed to our speakers. For those of you on the web, please use the Twitter account hashtag MedTalk. For each of our case studies, we like to extend the perspective of a patient or a family member who's experienced the condition that we're talking about. And today we're delighted to introduce Mr. Flood, who is a parent of a child with asthma and also on the board of directors for the Asthma and Allergy Foundation of America. With that, please welcome Mr. Flood.
Thank you. Thank you, doctor. Thank you very much. I'm mic'd. Thank you. Good morning, and thank you, everyone. My name is Jim Flood. I am an asthmatic, and I am the father of an asthmatic, a young boy, young, red-headed, little Irish-American-looking boy named Jimmy Flood. And I want to thank Brookings for inviting me to speak here today, and I'd like to share with you the story of our family, Jimmy's pediatric asthma, and hopefully give you some facts and context that help put this debate in perspective. Our story begins in the summer of 2001. My wife was pregnant with our first child, who was due on August the 8th. Well, we woke up on the morning of July the 4th, ready for a big party and a big picnic that night. My wife had been having some issues, had been communicating with her doctor, and was experiencing what she considered to be indigestion, quote unquote. We called the doctor, and the doctor said, oh no, I don't think it's indigestion. I think you may be in labor. My wife laughed, decided we'd have a nice leisurely breakfast, and we meandered our way down to Sibley Hospital, arriving at about 10:30 a.m. on the 4th of July. We went in, we met with the doctor. I remember I said to the doctor, doctor, we have a big party tonight. I need to go to Costco, and I need to buy hot dogs and hamburgers and all sorts of stuff. Will we be out of here by noon? And I remember, for those of you who remember the Bugs Bunny episodes, you know, there's the Bugs Bunny episodes where they talk in slow motion, and frozen in my brain is the doctor's face looking at me saying to me, by noon, you are going to have a baby, which was a complete and total shock, to say the least. So after I got over the shock and frankly a few prayers and realized that the Costco trip was out for the day, I noticed in the delivery room that there was a completely different team of doctors and nurses that sort of rushed into the room, had a table, a cart, and were obviously there for a reason, which I later learned they were the neonatal care unit, because as I now know, when a child is born 5-6 weeks prematurely, there's concern that the lungs may not function properly. So, needless to say, things moved quickly and faster, for those of you who like football, than a center can snap the ball to a quarterback. Jimmy was out and he was gone. And that was it. There was no holding the baby or bonding with the baby. It was out of the room to make sure that Jimmy was okay. For the next week, I could only visit Jimmy in the neonatal care unit, where, along with a bunch of other babies born on the 4th of July, he had his cute little white hat with his red, white, and blue ribbon. But even then, I noticed that something seemed to be slightly awry about Jimmy. He was coughing a lot, and it just didn't seem that when you held him that his breathing was particularly normal. About a week later, we went home, and that's sort of where our saga began. We noticed, literally from the beginning when we got home, that Jimmy would cough on a regular basis, he would occasionally gasp, he would sometimes spit up his food. And fairly early on, we went to a pediatric pulmonologist. We went to the pediatrician, who referred us to a pediatric pulmonologist who did a pulmonary function test and diagnosed Jimmy with asthma. Now, asthma was the last thing in the world that I had expected to be an issue for a child. As I learned later, I had quite a few relatives in Ireland who had what my mother referred to as the breathing disease, which she failed to disclose at the time. But now that I know that there was a genetic issue and Jimmy had an issue. And to be totally frank, it was terrifying at the beginning. My wife and I would take turns watching Jimmy at night, and we laugh now, but I would literally lie on the couch and stack pillows so that when Jimmy was in the crib, I could literally open my eyes, look down, and see that his chest was going up and down and that he was breathing. Like a lot of parents with pediatric asthmatic children, at the beginning, the only thing we knew to do was to go to the emergency room. So we went to the emergency room a few times, then, as I mentioned, went to the pediatric pulmonologist, and we got a nebulizer machine, which was completely foreign to me. So we learned very quickly to think in 4-hour increments, because basically, as those of you who treat asthma know, you know, a nebulizer machine, like a puffer, administers a bronchodilator. In this case, he was typically on albuterol, that will open the airways immediately and at least keep him in reasonable shape for 4-hour periods. So we would literally sort of plan it out, like, are we going out shopping? You know, can we get it done in the next 4 hours? Are we going, you know, to visit relatives? You know, what do we need to do to be ready? And sort of like a kid carrying their bag with sports, from then on in, we never left the house without, literally without a nebulizer machine or a puffer and a spacer, although we personally found that the machine worked a lot better. We went back and forth to the pulmonologist on a regular basis and eventually learned that it would be a good idea to put Jimmy on a steroid. Now, at the time, probably like a lot of Americans, the only image I had of steroids was professional athletes on anabolic steroids. So I thought, well, certainly we don't want to put our child, you know, several months old, on a steroid. Of course, I learned a lot more about corticosteroids, and in fact, we did put him on a steroid, which reduced the incidence of asthma attacks, but still didn't completely sort of eliminate the problem. And so we would sit there every day. We would have several good hours, and I would look down at Jimmy in the car seat, and when he would go into these coughing fits, it would literally feel like he had a gallon of water in his lungs that he was trying to expel, and he just could not get it out. Now, the other problem was for parents with children with pediatric asthma is they can't talk to you and tell you, you know, until they're about 4 or 5 years old, what's going on. You obviously can tell by virtue of the fluid, by virtue of the coughing. But there were occasions, quite frankly, where I later learned that if you're really in trouble with asthma, sometimes you won't get fluid at all, and you'll be so blocked up, you're not even coughing. And we had several incidents of that where we ended up taking Jimmy to the ER thinking it wasn't even asthma, only to find out that it actually was. When Jimmy got a little bit older, about 4 or 5 years old, like every little boy, his greatest interest in life was a ball. Football, soccer ball, baseball, didn't matter what kind of ball, he wanted to go out and play with the other kids. So we decided that we would enroll Jimmy in Little League. We live in Northern Virginia. We enrolled him in our local Little League. Well, as soon as Jimmy went to his first practice, it was very clear that he was not going to be able to play at the same level as other children. Jimmy was literally the slowest kid on the team. He literally was the slowest kid to get to the ball. And there were numerous occasions where we would have to take him off the field, and then we wouldn't nebulize him. At that point, we would administer albuterol through a spacer and then send him back out onto the field. And frankly, that made me very sad. And I really thought, I really didn't want Jimmy to feel different. I didn't want him to feel abnormal. So I reached out to the coach, who generally was pretty good about it, and said, look, I'll monitor Jimmy, you monitor the other kids. Starting with literally the next season, I decided that the best way to handle this was that I would just coach myself, because I was concerned, frankly, that a lot of coaches, you know, wouldn't spend the time, the energy, and would just basically throw Jimmy out and not pay attention to him. So I tried to turn Jimmy's asthma into a teaching moment for the other children. So when we would run the bases, Jimmy would always be the last to return home to home plate, and I would make the other kids stand at home plate and wait for Jimmy, their teammate. And I would tell them and explain to them, try to educate them to the extent that I understood it, that Jimmy was just like the rest of these children, but he had this disease called asthma, which meant that on occasion he had trouble breathing, and we had to be sensitive and watch out for Jimmy. And frankly, it was very cute, because the kids on occasion, if Jimmy was a little slow getting to second base, they would come in and they would say, Coach, you know, I wonder if Jimmy needs his puffer. Oh, Jimmy's got asthma, you know. And I would say, thank you very much, Billy. I appreciate it. I think he's okay. I think it'll work out fine. The same thing happened when Jimmy decided he wanted to play basketball. He was the slowest kid on the team. And I remember literally calling the coach, who probably thought I was crazy, and saying, look, my son is a pediatric asthmatic. He has asthma. It slows him down. If you are here to build an NBA championship team at age 7, please let me know, and I will coach Jimmy, because I don't want to make him feel different and have you throw him out, basically, or not treat him as a normal kid. Well, time went on, and Jimmy learned how to adjust. We learned how to adjust. He learned how to articulate, and obviously, we learned a lot more about the medicine. But the bottom line is that and now Jimmy's 13 years old. He had principally what was large airway obstruction, so he seems to have hit a nice balance now where he doesn't need his medicine as much. But my simple story to you is that when you are the parent of a pediatric asthmatic, you live a different life. You have to learn to emotionally and physically support a child who can't run as fast as the other kids, who has to go to the emergency room a lot, who misses a lot of days at school, who will be in the middle of a trip like we were to the Grand Canyon and have to leave looking at the Grand Canyon because he's having an asthma attack and he has to go to the doctor. You know, and these are serious issues, psychological issues and physical issues that you need to adjust to deal with as a parent of a child with an asthmatic. And I think it's important, and my message would be, that we educate parents, children, others around these children so they feel as normal as possible in their environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that delightful talk. Now I'd like to introduce a physician who has deep experience with working with asthmatic patients. So I'm going to introduce Dr. David Keller. He's a professor of pediatrics at the Children's Hospital of Colorado and is also the immediate past president of the Academic Pediatric Association. Thank you, Dr. Keller.
Well, thank you. And boy, it's great to be here. It's interesting to speak up here without a podium, so I'm getting used to that. I'm a general pediatrician. I've been in primary care practice for 30 years, and I've worked in hospital clinics. I've worked at a community health center. I ran a small practice in a small town in central Massachusetts for a bunch of years, and I've taken care of a lot of kids for asthma. The challenge with dealing with asthma is the same, and has been the same for a long time. How do we provide great care to our children and families that has good outcomes at a reasonable cost? Really, we're talking about the triple aim that was articulated so well by Don Berwick and his colleagues a few years ago. It's been a challenge for many years, and most of us have thought that we could only do two out of those three things, that we could get good outcomes at good cost, but then we'd have to speed up our care so that we wouldn't be able to provide all of those things. I never quite bought that. I always thought we could do all three things. And so back probably 20 years ago, I started going to learning collaboratives to learn how to take care of children with chronic diseases like asthma. I think my first one was in 1996. We've gotten better at it over the years, but we still have a long ways to go. Let me tell you what I mean. I'm going to start with a patient story, very similar to the one that we just heard, actually. The patient, someone I saw in my clinic the other day, and it really illustrates the points I want to make. Little girl, school age, let's call her Grace, came in for her annual physical. And I'd looked at her chart electronically before I walked into the room, and I noticed that she'd been to the emergency room twice over the last winter, both times for asthma, both times had gotten treated with nebulizers, as you'd heard, and most recently had a follow-up in our office about 3 months ago with one of my colleagues who appropriately prescribed what we now call a controller medication, an inhaled corticosteroid, which is another way of delivering the steroids you heard about in the earlier story. So her chart said that she had mild persistent asthma. Our team gave her an asthma control questionnaire to fill out when she got there. She scored 20, which is okay control. It says that things are just in control. So I asked what I thought was a perfectly reasonable question. How is Grace doing with her asthma? And her mother looked at me and looked shocked because she said to me, no one had ever told her that Grace had asthma before. Her chart said that she had asthma. The family didn't say that she had asthma. And that perception gap is the problem. That's the core of the issue that we need to deal with. Because many of our parents, because the clinical presentation of asthma is such that for families, it can look like it's an intermittent illness rather than a chronic disease. And we like it when children, we like to think of our children as being healthy, so we don't like to think of them as having a chronic disease. And that leads us to a lot of complications. Now, we in medicine have tried to deal with that. We've come up with classification systems to try and understand asthma as either mild, moderate, or severe. We have different treatment regimens for different levels of asthma that we use. We work with families to understand this. And yet, if we do our job properly, the child should appear well. A child with well-controlled asthma should be able to run and play with every other child, unlike the story we just heard. He should be able to go to school and not miss school very often. He or she should be able to sleep well at night and not wake up coughing in the middle of the night. All of those things should happen if you take your controller medications. But when you're taking your controller medications, you appear to be a well child, and it can be hard for parents to remember to stay on them. To believe that they really need to be on them. So a lot of the work we have to do as primary care physicians is really educate people to understand the nature of asthma and what it is that we need to work through. The other problem with asthma is not an equal opportunity disease. It affects poor children more than it affects those who don't live in poverty. And there's a bunch of reasons for that, most of them environmental. Environmental tobacco smoke, for example, is a big problem for kids with asthma. Early exposure to environmental tobacco smoke increases the rate of asthma by like 30% early on in life. It's a real problem, and getting people to quit smoking is really hard. We do that in our offices now, but I think it's a challenge for us. We have, add to that, the problem of living in inadequate housing. If you have housing that has lots of dust or cockroaches or rats, you notice the symbols all appearing behind me, or dust, something like 80 or 90% of children with asthma have allergies attached to that asthma, and that these things just stir it up. They trigger asthma attacks that result in frequent trips to the hospital and actually can result in requiring higher doses of corticosteroids with more side effects that go along with that. So that can be a problem. Finally, add to that just living in crowded conditions. When you live in crowded conditions, you get sick more often with viral illnesses. That triggers more asthma. And I'm looking at my time. And that triggers more asthma, especially with a virus called respiratory syncytial virus, which when contracted early in life really causes problems for children. So we have all of these environmental triggers that lead to poverty being a major factor in the distribution of asthma around our country. All of this results in costs. $27 billion a year were spent on pediatric asthma care. It's an annual direct cost of about $3,000 per child. Then you go add to that the cost of missing school. 14 million, we estimate, sick days per year of missed school days. And that doesn't even account for all the missed work days for the parents who have to stay home with their children when they're sick from school. This is a tremendous cost to our society, to our payers, and to the families, and needs to be addressed as we move forward with designing systems to try and deal with all of this. So what do we do about this? Well, the good news is we actually have the scientific evidence to know what to do. There have been evidence-based guidelines in existence since 1993. They've been regularly updated, telling us how best to manage asthma care. All children with asthma should have their asthma graded and their treatment designed appropriately around the severity of their disease. All families and children should work with their providers to have an asthma action plan to try and know what they should do to handle the asthma when it happens. They should use their inhalers properly and be trained in how to do that, and they should have regular visits with their pediatrician or their asthma or their care provider to address fine-tuning their asthma care. Next slide. And that is the challenge before us, because what you can see is that in caring for children with asthma, the problem isn't about the medicine and the science. The problem is designing a system of care that supports families in such a way that they get the right treatment for the right problem at the right time. It really is all about the triple aim. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Keller. So there are pediatricians all over the country who are providing excellent care to their patients, but one physician in particular has introduced an innovative new program, which has been very successful in changing the way that care is delivered. I'm delighted to introduce Dr. Elizabeth Woods, who's going to describe the Community Asthma Initiative. Dr. Woods is a professor of pediatrics at the Boston Children's Hospital, and thank you so much.
It is a great honor to be here. I would like to thank Brookings for this forum, as well as our Community Asthma Initiative partners, staff, and families. Let me tell you about what we did at Boston Children's Hospital to provide an enhanced care to children with asthma. A community needs assessment was performed by the Office of Community Health at Boston Children's Hospital using a community participatory approach in 2005, which identified asthma as one of the top community concerns. In this process, asthma is found to be the leading cause of hospitalizations at Boston Children's, and 70% of the children came from five low-income neighboring communities that were predominantly African-American and Latino. The asthma hospitalization rates for African-American and Latino youth were 4 to 5 times those for white children, and this suggested a major health disparity. The target population was initially identified as children 2 to 18 years of age from 4 zip code areas with high asthma rates during the pilot program that corresponded to Roxbury and Jamaica Plain communities of Boston, seen in the yellow hashed areas on the map. Children served by the program were compared to four demographically similar zip code communities of North and South Dorchester, seen in orange, during the pilot program, though now we serve most of the low-income communities of Boston. Patients are identified through logs of emergency department visits, admissions at the time of an event, and we help connect patients back to their primary care sites. In addition, we now accept referrals from primary care providers for patients with similarly poorly controlled asthma that they identify. Data are provided by parents as part of clinical care, and we're approved for access to the hospital administrative data for Community Asthma Initiative patients and patients from the comparison community for cost analyses. The Community Asthma Initiative provides care coordination by bilingual and or bicultural nurses and community health workers. They work with families to establish their own goals for asthma control. They identify barriers to good control through tailored education about asthma and medications. They discuss medication adherence. They investigate the home and school triggers and discuss the family's access to insurance and issues with co-payments. Environmental assessment and remediation is provided, including materials such as vacuum cleaners, bedding encasings, and integrated pest management materials tailored to the needs of the family. The Community Asthma Initiative provides connections to community resources such as housing advocacy and inspectional services, especially to the Boston Public Health Commission's Breathe Easy at Home program and other resources. We work closely with partners from the city, state, and state public health and numerous community agencies around healthy housing and building a business case for sustainable funding. Up until now, the program has been funded through grants, philanthropy, and internal support, and we're grateful to our funders, including the Health Resources and Actions Center for Medicaid and Medicare Services Innovation Grant, Maternal and Child Health Bureau's Healthy Tomorrows and Leadership in Adolescent Health Grants, the CDC REACH US Program, the American Academy of Pediatrics, and several other smaller foundations, as well as the Office of Community Health at Boston Children's. You may want to see our website for links to our partners. So now I will tell you about our findings. To date, we've served 1,361 patients and families. 77% of the families received home visits by nurses and/or community health workers. The average age of our patients is 7 years old. 45% are Latino, 47% are African American, 23% of parents are primarily Spanish speaking. 63% have an annual household income of less than $25,000 a year, and the group in the next income bracket have a particularly hard time with copays. And 75% have Medicaid, which is in Massachusetts, it's called MassHealth. We collected data at baseline, 6 months, and 12 months after enrollment and found highly significant improvements in health outcomes. There was a 57% decrease in the percent of patients with any, one or more, emergency department visits, and 80% decrease in the percent of patients with any admissions due to asthma at 12 months follow-up. Similarly, there was a 43% reduction in patients with any missed school days and 51% reduction in parents with any missed work days due to asthma. This is an important slide that we really want to pause on and think about. On this side, you see the Community Asthma Initiative patients and the comparison population. It looks at the average cost per patient for the Community Asthma Initiative patients in blue compared to two similar communities, as we discussed, that were not served in the initial pilot using hospital administrative data. The Community Asthma Initiative patients have higher asthma-related costs initially, because we do triage our patients and serve those with intensive care admissions first, then regular medical admissions, and then those with two emergency department visits, and then those with one. It's important to see that the reduction in cost for the Community Asthma Initiative patients exceeds the reduction for the comparison community and continues to decline. in the second year, even though we serve patients primarily just for 1 year. This is presumably due to the use of continued use of controller medications and reductions in allergens in the home. The return on investment for the program is 1.46, indicating that for every dollar spent on the program, $1.46 are saved by insurers and society. We adjust for the cost of missed school days and missed work days, and there's a 1.73 social return on investment. Importantly, the cost per patient served has been optimized over the years and is now down to $2,060 per patient using a nurse-supervised community health worker model. However, there is an average of two family members with asthma yielding a cost of $1,000 per family members. However, don't forget that half of the family members may well be adults and are not likely to be recovered by a pediatric program. In conclusion, the program needs to transition from funding primarily from grants, philanthropy, and internal support to more sustainable funding mechanisms. As we replicate the model, the emphasis needs to be to work with primary care sites where funding may be provided in part by insurers. As we work with medical homes, population management mechanisms need to be in place to rapidly identify patients with poorly controlled asthma to provide direct referrals to the community health workers, even if the patients are not well known by their clinicians and are not even necessarily accessing care well. The Community Asthma Initiative needs to work with insurers to pilot and test funding mechanisms, and that this may vary from insurer to insurer. As an example of innovative funding models, we're thrilled that you'll be hearing more about the Massachusetts Medicaid bundled payment pilot later this morning, which we hope to participate in. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Woods. As we can see, there are approaches which can improve outcomes and decrease costs for patients with pediatric asthma. But the question remains, how do we pay for these kinds of interventions? Next, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Darshak Sanghavi, who is formerly with the Brookings Institution and now is Director of Population Health at the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation.
Thanks, Steve. Appreciate it. Can y'all hear me okay? So it seems like when we talk about asthma, one of the things I've taken away here is that asthma is a chronic disease. But as a chronic disease, the treatments for it are fairly straightforward. Why don't we send people to children's houses, exterminate the cockroaches that are leading them to have the asthma exacerbations? The inhalers are actually hard to use. You have to use a spacer. You're supposed to shake it an appropriate amount of time. It's actually not so easy. And yet the fix is pretty simple. It's education, having somebody go to your house to teach you how to use an inhaler. Or you can even say, well, when you actually start to feel sick, when you feel like you're actually having trouble breathing, why do you have to go to an emergency room? Why don't we have an easy way to access care so that they tell you what to do at home? You can avoid going to the ER. You don't need to leave your family at the Grand Canyon. You can actually enjoy your life. We know what to do. And what you've just heard about is a little bit about, well, what some programs are doing in innovative ways to get that care to people where they need it, in ways that actually save money. So one of the things I would want to know is, why isn't everybody doing this? It makes a lot of sense. And I think I'd like to quote what Paul Batalden has said, which said, every system is designed to get exactly the result it gets. In other words, most people aren't doing this. Why is it? And that's what I want to talk about and then explore some of the things that we at the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation and others are doing to try to make these incentives line up a little better. In 2010 was a passage of the Affordable Care Act, which in many fundamental ways was about getting health insurance for people that didn't have it. It improved access to care. But equally important is a series of innovations that are baked into that legislation that will actually change the delivery of care as well. And where is that problem? It's very simple to any of you who have hired a contractor for your house. I had this experience 10 years ago. And how does that work? Everything they do, they get paid extra, right? They don't hang up your kitchen cabinets on time. That's great. That's a couple more days of work, right? You pay for every time they feel like they need to install another window in your house. You're going to get a house with a lot of windows. Now, I'm a doctor, you've heard from a lot of doctors, but we're also people. We all respond to financial incentives. And when you get paid to do more and more and more, and nobody holds you accountable for quality, what happens? You do more and more and more and don't hold yourself accountable. And that's true not only individual level, on the system level as well. And so what we're talking about is, how do we make that better? And the term for that is fee-for-service medicine. But what it's really about is paying for more and more and more and not accounting or holding people accountable for quality. How do we make that better? And I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the strategies that are out there to do that, that ideally could be more and more applied to the treatment of pediatric asthma, but in fundamental ways should reshape the way we think about healthcare funding, financing, and delivery more broadly. The first is this thing called an ACO. And I remember a couple years ago, I was like, what is an ACO? Yeah, I don't know. So let's sort of take a minute and just explain what this is. Because as we said, what it is it, before you had an intensive care unit, you have a hospital, you have an emergency room. Now that you have primary care, the pharmacy, everybody works differently. Everybody gets paid differently. So if I work in an emergency room and every time somebody goes in, it's essentially a cash machine. I love when people come to the ER. I'm going to put up signs and say, our wait's only 2 minutes, come to my ER, right? People do that all the time. Why is that? Why when you show up in an ER, why don't they just call your primary care doctor and say, you know, Johnny's here to see us today. He probably just ran out of his inhaler. Do you mind if I just call in a prescription and kind of, we won't charge him for that ER visit? Makes a lot of sense. Nobody's ever going to do that. An ACO structure is different. It says, let's put everything together. You are going to have a combined group right here. And then at the end of the year, we're going to add up all the money that they charge and compare that to a target. So suddenly, all those incentives are aligned. If they go to the emergency room, that's going to cost a lot of money. That's not good. You're going to want to actually have that child go and get that prescription refilled. In a way, what you do is then you hold that global target in mind. And at the end of the year, you say, well, okay, let's compare that to the target. Did you save money overall? And if you did, tell you what, you're going to get that to take home as a bonus. This is the basic concept of the accountable care organization. There's many forms and flavors of it that are quite complicated. However, the bottom line is this, is that early studies at least seem to show, and just this week, the Pioneer ACOs at the Innovation Center showed we had remarkable savings on the orders of tens of millions of dollars at various centers across the country. This is one way of getting off that treadmill. What's another way? So you just talked about this fee-for-service system, right? Every time you do something, you get paid more. Everybody makes a lot of money. This is why doctors drive nice cars. It's why health systems make tons and tons of money. Again, they're doing not because they're bad people. It's because what the system incentivizes you to do. But what if we did it a little bit differently? What if for an asthmatic child, when they first hit your system, and they had pretty bad asthma, as you've heard about, we said, tell you what, we're going to pay you a lump sum up front. We're not going to micromanage you, even though we're the government. We're going to let you figure that out. You figure out how are you going to, you can go to their house, do that extermination, send a community health worker to their house, make sure they're using their asthma medication appropriately. When they call your clinic, pick up the phone and call them back. Have services 24 hours. You figure that out. And you know what? We think that that's actually going to be great because that's going to lead to an emergency room visit not happening. It's going to lead to savings in that way. And at the end of the year, because you got that money up front, you can keep the difference. Again, this is a different way of aligning those incentives. And the benefit of a bundle is that you may not have to get all the hospitals in your area together. This is a smaller and simpler way to get where you want to be. Heard about ACOs and bundles. Talk about this other concept, something called a patient-centered medical home. Sounds great, right? What is it exactly? Because I remember, again, we've done a bad job of explaining this. You know, I actually worked at a health center. We had a medical home. I didn't even know what it was. But the concept makes a lot of sense. It's very simple. You have a complicated patient. You have a patient with asthma. Here's what we're going to do. What you need is you need to kind of get out of this treadmill of having these 10-minute visits where you don't have time to talk to your patients, to understand what's going on at school, in the home. Take that extra time to say, well, how are you using that inhaler? Show me how you're doing it. What's that copay you're paying anyway? How often are you getting sick? What kind of housing do you do? That takes time. It takes 10 to 15 minutes is all you get budgeted. Instead, we'll do this. If you have one of those patients in your clinic, we'll give you a bonus every month. We call that a per Benny per month or per member per month. It can be $5, $10, but that adds up. And so you can say, you know what? For all of our asthmatic patients, we actually want them to come to our clinic. Because you know what? We're going to use that money. And we're not going to use that to line our pockets. We're going to use that to hire somebody. We're going to use it to get those services. We're going to use that per member per month, put that together, and figure out what are the services they need. It's the same way of redirecting money from that typical fee-for-service stream into services that actually give you much higher value and higher quality. Basic concepts. Now, how do we get from here to there? There's a couple ways you can do it. You can sort of spring it on the system as a whole. You know, just impose it. People don't like that. They like to be incremental. That's okay. Again, we're the government. We can be incremental. We live incremental. All right? So that's what we're going to do. So this is what the Innovation Center does, is we move those experiments along. As we speak, there are accountable care organizations across the country. There are bundle payment pilots happening across the country. There are medical home demonstration projects happening across the country. So I think this is a time for great optimism and innovation within healthcare. I'm particularly optimistic because I have to be, given what we do. But I think that at the end of the day, what do we all want? We want people to have a higher quality of life. We want these kids to be able to go to school. We want them to enjoy and be normal so they can play on those basketball teams, baseball teams, and actually not be seen as those who simply have chronic diseases. And I say that not only as a pediatrician myself, somebody with the government, but also as somebody as a child who had asthma. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sangavi. Those are some really interesting concepts that you're introducing. For our next speaker, we're going to talk about how some of these different payment models have been implemented in two different states. The first of them we're going to talk about is Massachusetts, and I'm pleased to present Catherine London, who is principal at the Center for Health Law and Economics at the University of Massachusetts Medical School.
To talk, my part of this this morning session is a little bit more technical than what you've heard, although I actually am also a patient with asthma and I have a child with asthma and experience many of the same stories as Jim Flood described, so I actually have a very strong personal investment as well, even though all I can do on this side is the numbers and not the actual patient care. Darshak talked about what these alternative payment methods are that are being developed around the country. I want to talk a little bit about what we're implementing in Massachusetts, some of the opportunities that these alternative payment methods provide for funding innovative service models, and also the challenges of implementing these methods. So Massachusetts in 2012 passed a health reform law that has a goal of containing costs. And the way this law works is that it establishes a statewide benchmark for growth in total health expenditures. And if the total health expenditures for the state exceed the benchmark, the state looks at every healthcare entity, every healthcare provider, every health plan. And if a healthcare entity's costs are high relative to its peers and its cost growth exceeds the benchmark, then the state can require the healthcare entity to submit a performance improvement plan. And if trends don't improve, the state can impose fines on that healthcare entity. And the way that the law anticipates containing costs is moving towards these alternative payment methods, away from fee-for-service, towards payment methods that reward quality outcomes and greater efficiency. And in particular, this, the method requires the Massachusetts Medicaid program to make 80% of its payments using alternative payment methods by 2015, which is very soon. So Massachusetts Medicaid has developed a number of initiatives that work towards providing these innovative care models for particular populations using alternative payment methods. And there are a whole bunch of different initiatives. around care for disabled people, elders who are eligible for both Medicare and Medicaid, children with severe and persistent mental illness, people with chronic care conditions. But what I want to talk about today is the Children's High-Risk Asthma Bundled Payment Demonstration Program. It's a bit of a mouthful. We refer to it as the CHAPPY, which is sort of an acronym of all of that. And all of these programs use this idea that we're trying to provide more and better coordinated primary care, preventive care, in order to prevent hospital care, which is more expensive and more traumatic for the child. And if you look at the cost, you know, we might know that the cost to Medicaid for an inpatient hospitalization for asthma is about $6,000. For an emergency department visit might be $1,000. And preventive care for a whole year might cost $600. So you look at this and you say, oh, great, $600 is less than $1,000. $600 is less than $6,000. We should give this preventive care to all of our kids with asthma. Well, it turns out that if you take this broad-based approach and you give the same bundle of preventive services to all of the kids with asthma, your preventive costs are very, very high. And even though your hospital costs come down a fair amount, we hope, the total costs go way up and you exceed your budget. And as a state Medicaid program, you just can't afford to do that. And as a provider accepting one of these alternative payment methods, you would lose your shirt when you're taking risks. You can't do this. So what we need to do is think about how to target. We know that in healthcare, 20% of the patients generate 80% of the costs. And in fact, 5% of the patients generate about 50% of the costs. So the trick is to try to identify which children are most likely to require this expensive hospital care if they don't receive the preventive services, and to try to identify those children before they end up in the emergency room, before they end up in the hospital. And it turns out that this is really hard to do. And I think that this is actually really the hardest part of this whole change in the delivery service and the payment system. So what we did in Massachusetts, so we spent a lot of time talking with our advisory committee about how to target these funds. And what we came up with was two different criteria. One is that the children had to have high-risk asthma, the most severe, as described by Dr. Keller before. And we described this as children who in the last 12 months have had a hospitalization, have had an emergency visit, have had an observation stay for asthma, or have a prescription for an oral corticosteroid. So that's the high-risk aspect. But then we decided that actually that's not enough, because actually many of those children have very well-controlled asthma, and they're, you know, they have all of their medications, and they know what to do, their families are set, they're fine. So we wanted to look also at children who have poorly controlled asthma. And so those are symptoms like waking up at night with asthma, experiencing frequent shortness of breath, missing school days because of asthma. And those are kind are symptoms that we can't pick up through a Medicaid administrative claims system. That's symptoms that the clinician can ask about in the office. You can call the family and find this out. But we can't do it administratively in the Medicaid program. So this required developing a program that allows the clinician to enroll children into this initiative. And that's a very different model than what state Medicaid agencies are used to. Usually, Medicaid programs select people for particular programs based on their own data and enroll them. So establishing a protocol that allows the clinician to identify and enroll children in these initiatives was a big change. And a further challenge for state Medicaid programs, as most of you know, state Medicaid programs need to get approval from the federal agency, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, for most of what they do, either through a state plan amendment or through a waiver and very detailed protocol documents. But CMS, these kind of programs are very new to CMS, and CMS is just in process of developing a standard way of evaluating them, and there isn't really a process for small tests of change. So our process of working with the federal agency was very much one of learning together how to approach these issues and how to work through all of them. But the number of questions that come up, you know, this targeting that we talked about, how do you choose the children to be enrolled? How do you let them know that they're enrolled? How do you determine what services they're going to get? How do you develop your budget. How do you ensure that the provider is not paid twice, once through this bundled payment method and another time fee-for-service if you have that continuing also, or through one of your other many initiatives that MassHealth has? And how do you know in the end that you in fact improved outcomes and that you contain costs? How do you know that you have a positive return on investment, which we're required to do by Massachusetts law? So all of these questions required a fair amount of planning, and we've been working through it for quite some time, but I'm very excited that we've just received approval from the federal agency and the program will be launching shortly. And I hope to be able to report to you soon that it was very successful in improving outcomes for these children. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments on how these reforms have been implemented in Massachusetts. Now we're going to turn to another example, which is the state of Arkansas, which has implemented some of these models as well. So I'm pleased to introduce now Dr. Joe Thompson, who is Surgeon General for the state of Arkansas.
Thank you. Thank you for having us here. It's an exciting time. Let me define Surgeon General. I'm actually a pediatrician in the College of Medicine of University of Arkansas, for which the last decade, two governors, one Republican Governor Huckabee, now Democratic Governor Beebe, have asked me to serve as their strategic advisor on their cabinet. So it's a unique perspective that I'm going to bring you in a report from the field. If we could go forward, about 4 years ago, in the middle of the recession, with rising healthcare costs and decreasing state revenue, the governor asked me, why is this a problem? And I said, because our payment incentives are not aligned for outcomes. They're aligned for volume. And he said, fix it. So we went to work to try to fix it. We first started with a workforce strategic plan. We had no strategic plan for our state for workforce. We second added a strong effort on health information technology. Many of our physicians were not using the electronic health record. We have done a unique private option expansion of Medicaid for over 200,000, 85% of our target population in the last 6 months. That's another talk that I won't go into. But to be able to afford the expansion, we had to modify the way we were paying. So in the discussion on the payment side, what became clear is that lots of people had tried lots of things, but they were always from the perspective of the individual payer. It was Medicaid trying something. It was Blue Cross trying something. It was QualChoice trying something, or Medicare trying something. So we actually went to the four major payers, and we said, how do we bring the incentives together? Because we need to put new resources into the clinical care system if we expect them to transform out of their traditional fee-for-service system. We had to align the incentives of every payer to reinforce that transformation, and then we had to provide actual support in terms of stability for those providers to be able to move forward. So we started with QualChoice, Blue Cross, Medicaid. They were having the same conversation, but using different language. They're two very different programs, Medicaid, an entitlement guaranteed program, drawdown money from the federal government, private carriers, fixed pool of money that they're managing to an actuarial cost. We attracted other carriers. And finally, we started getting our self-insureds, the state employees, the University of Arkansas employees, and even sold a national corporation that what we were doing was unique and different. So let me share with you how that works. Our approach meant putting a quarterback always in charge of the patient. Now, we have some technical words in our Medicaid rules for this of what it is, but effectively, a quarterback always in charge, whether it was in the patient-centered medical home space or in the acute inflammatory space for asthma, a hospitalization, or an ER visit. Let's go to the patient-centered medical home. This is not a building. This is a physician-led team paid to be responsible for keeping that child or that adult healthy. It includes nurse practitioners that can be the primary care provider. It includes care coordinators. It reaches outside for community health workers. It touches the pharmacist. Our goal is to have that patient-centered medical home team wrapped around the patient, with resources coming to it, the dollars per member per month, and that they are responsible for the best outcomes and the total cost of care for each individual patient. They get 50% of the savings of the system for the total cost of care for reaching out and wrapping around the individual. Now, what they don't want to have happen is an emergency room visit for an asthmatic or a hospitalization. But when it does happen, we want there to be a quarterback inside of the hospital system responsible for the individual, making sure that the right thing happens at the right time, making sure that we avoid potential quality problems or harm, and that when the child leaves the hospital, the quarterback's still in charge for the next 30 days. In other words, an ER visit or a hospitalization makes this individual at the hospital responsible for the post-hospital care and the reconnection back over into the patient-centered medical home. If they get it right, and we use Arkansas-specific numbers to say what that is, with quality indicators required first, then they can actually get part of the savings back. If they get it wrong, they're a high-cost provider, they have a readmission, they didn't get the child reconnected with the patient-centered medical home, they owe money back. So in the bundle, it's a two-sided risk model. In the patient-centered medical home, it's gain-sharing only. We have now a significant proportion of our population under this effort. Going forward, I think what's going to be the biggest challenge is attracting Medicare to be a participant in our player. We are publicly committed to getting 70 to 80% of all purchases under a value-based option in the next 2 to 3 years. We're well on our way with a multi-payer effort. We have about 15 bundles out and operational, one of which is asthma. We have our patient-centered medical homes with over 70% of our Medicaid beneficiaries under a shared savings patient-centered medical home model. And importantly, in our insurance marketplace, which is where our private option Medicaid beneficiaries are now, every carrier is required to participate in our patient-centered medical home model with per member per month payments and shared savings. Our goal is to have every payer unified in the signal and in the reinforcement of financial incentives into our clinical community to change from a fee-for-service volume-based model to an outcomes-based model, which will get what you want as a parent and other parents of asthmatics across the United States: high quality, continuous wraparound care. Thank you for the opportunity to be here.
Avi described new payment models and how they can support these non-traditional medical services. Sorry for the technical difficulty. So three major themes emerged from this case study. The first is that clinical leadership is central to successful healthcare reform. Clinicians are in an ideal position to identify gaps in care and opportunities for improvement, but they've often in the past lacked a mechanism to implement those interventions. These new payment models offer new opportunities to accomplish these changes to the healthcare system. But success in these new payment models depends critically upon creating value, which is the intersection of both cost and quality. Recognizing that pediatric asthma was an important problem in her community, Dr. Woods in the Boston Children's Hospital developed the Community Asthma Initiative. The idea was simple. Through preventive measures, they could improve outcomes and reduce costs. They introduced community health workers and introduced environmental remediation services, which are services which are not traditionally paid for through the fee-for-service medical system.
The CAI has been successful in demonstrating a positive return on investment, and yet it is primarily supported through grant funding and philanthropic mechanisms. And the pathway to sustainability comes through these new payment models, and in particular, through bundled payments and shared savings models. In Arkansas, Dr. Thompson described how a new payment system was developed, which was born out of financial crisis. At the heart of this, the Arkansas reforms are a provider or a group of providers who are held accountable for outcomes, costs, and the patient experience. Providers in the Arkansas models have a greater ability to innovate and to offer services which directly meet the needs of their unique patient populations. But at the same time, they're held accountable for the costs, the overall costs of the care that they're providing. Physicians have limited experience with these new models, but they offer a tremendous promise to improve healthcare. Yet, at the core of all of these new models is clinical leadership. Clinicians need to identify those opportunities and find ways to implement them and to critically reevaluate how care can be provided. The second major theme is that payers play a critical role in successful healthcare reform. But payers need to create a compelling business case for providers to participate in these new models. Payers cannot realistically expect that large numbers of providers are going to participate in new payment mechanisms if they are likely to lead to losses, financial losses. Conversely, physicians cannot assume that increased funds will increasingly be available to introduce new innovations without being held accountable for the growing costs of healthcare. Assessing the business case for these new payment models is really challenging, in part because some payment is delivered on a fee-for-service basis, while others may be developed, may be paid for through bundled payment mechanisms. And some clinicians will find it really challenging to anticipate how much they are going to be paid and what resources will ultimately be available for their patients. The uncertainty associated with these new payment models also adds to business risk for individual provider entities and hospital facilities. Given this complexities, many physicians may be hesitant to participate if it's on a voluntary basis, just as a job seeker would hesitate to take a position where there's no clear salary. While investment in community health services and environmental remediation can clearly improve outcomes in patients with pediatric asthma, for physicians to make major changes to the way that they're delivering care, especially if those changes require large upfront investments, they will need to have a financial incentive which is sufficiently large to justify those investments. And those incentives have to be very clear. If, as in Massachusetts, you have primary care medical homes where providers get $12.50 per member per month for all patients, and in addition receive a $50 per member per month payment on top for patients who are in a high-risk asthma diagnosis, there may be sufficient funds to extend the spectrum of care. In Arkansas, if you have an acute care bundle paired with primary care medical homes, which receive majority of their care on a fee-for-service basis and receive an additional $4 per member per month for coordination of services, they may choose instead to better coordinate care with existing public health services. Which of these two approaches is best remains to be determined. The third major theme is that the roots of poorly controlled pediatric asthma reside in the community. As Dr. Keller articulately expressed, the social determinants, socioeconomic factors, largely drive many of the factors which make asthma very difficult to control. These factors include poor quality housing, indoor air pollution, secondhand smoke exposure, and low health literacy, Dr. Woods described the importance of culturally appropriate patient education and environmental remediation in addressing this problem. The healthcare system can address some of these factors, but can't always address all of them. And it's important to recognize that the public health system also has an important role to play here. Healthcare reform has often addressed the medical care system rather than the public health system, but many of these interventions better align with the public health system. The public health system offers a large spectrum of services which are relevant to patients with pediatric asthma, but has not always been well coordinated or easy to access. In addition, the public health system is chronically underfunded and is becoming even more so as medical care expenses continue to grow. There are clearly important public health interventions which can be delivered through the medical care system, but these should not supplant the primary preventive role of the public health system. And my concern is that if we provide too many public health interventions through the medical system, that it will further exaggerate the imbalance between medical spending and public health spending. A strong and adequately funded public health system is necessary to coordinate the different state and federal agencies which are relevant to management of the public health and reduce the risk of pediatric asthma. Selectively paying for some services through the medical system may make sense, particularly because changes to the public health system will take time to develop. Alternatively, coordinating existing public health services through the medical system may be a good alternative. So our case today explored the ways in which payment reform can improve the care of patients with pediatric asthma. Physicians account for or direct the vast majority of healthcare spending and must be part of the solution to improving outcomes and reducing costs. If you're watching this video or if you are in the room today and you have patients with pediatric asthma and you see gaps in care or opportunities for improvement, new payment models may offer a sustainable funding solution to implement those changes. A practical next step is to identify which of these interventions are most relevant to your specific patient population and to assess the cost and scope of intervening, of creating these interventions in your patient population. With this information, you'll be in a better position to assess whether or not it makes sense for you to participate in new payment models and potentially also to engage in payers, engage with payers to get resources to implement these new interventions for your patients. Engaging in these new payer models now, or these new payment mechanisms now, even if it's on a small scale, will stand you in good stead in the future as these new payment models become far more widely implemented. I want to thank you so much for your attention. And now we're going to have a question and answer session. I hopefully will get some great questions from the audience. And in addition, we'll get some questions by tweet over the internet. I'd like to introduce Dr. Gary Sennett, who is formerly with Brookings and is now the president and CEO of the Asthma and Allergy Foundation of America. I'd like to invite our speakers to come up to the stage for this discussion.
So let me do a sound check while we're getting organized here. Can you hear me all right? Yes? Good. Okay. So while we're getting organized, let me just begin by saying, first of all, thank you, Steve, for the introduction. Thank you all for the opportunity to be here. And good morning, everyone, both in the room and on the web. We've been given a lot to think about in the last hour and 15 minutes. And I very much look forward to your questions, your comments, and in some cases, your comments disguised as questions. But I'm going to reserve the moderator's prerogative and ask the first question, give you all a chance to line your questions up. And I am quite intentionally going to ask the first question of Jim Flood. Jim, you're the patient. You're the voice of the patient in this conversation. And I think it's very important that that voice guide and the transformation that's underway be anchored in the patient's perspective. So, father of a child with asthma, but also someone whose feet are firmly planted in the policy world, from your perspective, what are we aiming for? What does patient-centered care really mean? And what are the two or three things that you think are most important for us to keep our eyes on, for us to focus on?
Well, thank you for the question, Carrie. I think what we're aiming for is helping parents and patients help themselves. And I think if you do that, you will end up addressing the cost issue as well. There are three particular things that I often think of. The first is education. I'm tremendously grateful to folks that took the time to educate myself, my wife, and Jimmy about what asthma is, what the symptoms are, when to quote unquote panic, when not to panic. And I think that's tremendously helpful. And I still think, despite lots of efforts and funding, that there's not enough education, particularly in our school system around the country, on asthma. The second point I would just make is what patients could use is understanding how to create a plan. Several of our speakers today articulated there are various models of the plan where you are diagnosed, you know whether you're moderate, you're severe asthmatic, and that allows you, therefore, to develop a plan where you know, if I'm having issues, now it's time to articulate them to a school nurse. Now it's time to use my bronchodilator. You know, now it's time to go back to the pediatric pulmonologist. And the final thing I think you can do for patients is simply provide support, such as through events like this, because I think the more support that is provided, whether it's through events like this or even through, as the Surgeon General said, through systems payment models where you have a quote-unquote quarterback, the more you can assure adherence to the medication, you know, make the patients feel better, and ultimately, I think, reduce the cost.
Thank you. So I will take questions, and if I don't get questions, I'll keep asking them, which I'm delighted to do. I would ask that folks raise their hand, and then I believe if you press the button on your mic, it'll allow us all to hear. A light should go on. So question in the back, please. And if you'd briefly just introduce yourself, identify yourself, and then ask the question, direct it to an individual, if that makes sense. So can folks hear, or should I repeat the question? Very, very briefly, I think the question is from the Green and Healthy Homes Initiative, which is an entity that's been very successful at improving outcomes for people with asthma through intervening in the home, but historically has been funded through housing and urban development, sort of grants. How can we build a financing model that recognizes the critical value that they're creating and provide some sustainability and generalizability? So, David, I don't know who'd like to begin. David, you want to?
Raised my hand because this is one of my favorite issues to talk about. And what you're really talking about is recognizing that healthcare is not the only thing that affects health, and that the key to everything that we're trying to do here is to break down the silos that have created situations like this, where your program is funded through one funding stream that doesn't necessarily talk to my program, which is funded through another funding stream. The patient-centered medical home model is actually a really nice way to do that, because within that model, you can define a lot of different roles, and you can have a role for community health workers within a PCMH. Certainly one of the things that we were thinking of when we were designing the asthma bundle payment initiative in Massachusetts. Full disclosure, by the way, many of us have worked together on the asthma bundle payment initiative in Massachusetts, so you hear about that, you'll hear about that one a lot. But I think it comes down to thinking, when you're thinking about a patient-centered medical home, who's on the team and how do you get a broad enough team to be able to do your kind of work? I mean, we should also have school nurses on that team, because the role of the school, as was just pointed out, in asthma care is critical, but often the school just barely talks to the healthcare system, that sort of thing. So we need to be breaking down. I think what you've really highlighted is we need to break down silos, and that means we need to merge funding streams to be able to do that.
Darshak?
I'm just going to add to that very briefly, which is that you say, well, why would anybody be against that, right? We all think that's a good idea, right? You want to exterminate these pests from homes, make sure they have an air conditioner and so forth. And part of the issue is that, think about that. When you start to give out that benefit, you know, hell, I want an air conditioner in my bedroom too, right? And how do you sort of make sure that the benefit you're offering, which, to be honest, is can be expensive, is targeted to those who are going to benefit the most? So I think you, I said, how do you create an economic case? I think this is exactly what Catherine is referring to, that prevention makes a lot of sense, but surprisingly, some kinds of prevention end up costing a lot more money. So part of it is it's incumbent on you, as you think about making that case, or CMS or others, to say, well, okay, we like this idea. How do we make sure that that benefit reaches those to whom it's best targeted, and ultimately then overall saves the system money? If it's going to cost more, that still might be a good idea, but then that's got to compete against a lot of other priorities, because there's a lot of stuff that costs money that could help people.
So I'll just add to that, that, you know, that the point of the Children's Asthma High-Risk Asthma Bundled Payment Demonstration Program in Massachusetts is to demonstrate the proof of concept that a state Medicaid agency can pay for the kinds of remediation services that you're talking about and can have a positive ROI for the state. And so I'm hoping that we'll be able to provide the evidence for that so that you'll be able to use that to go to, if you're doing this as a community service organization, yes, so maybe you'll be able to take that evidence and go to your community practices, clinical practices, and say, look, this is what we can do for your patients. To the extent that those practices are accepting some kind of a global payment, they're in an ACO, they're accountable for the care of their patients, you can go to them and say, look, we can provide this service for your patient. You pay us this amount per kid who meets this requirement, who meets the target that Darshak's talking about, and we can work with that families to help reduce the asthma symptoms for that kid.
So I think one of the things that has been pointed out very clearly is that a fundamental problem with the care that's delivered to children with asthma has to do with the nature of fee-for-service. If you pay for service, you get more service, you get more intensive service. I think the other point that needs to be made on the payment front is the fractionation of payment, that we're paying for health care. And what's really needed here is a much broader view and payment for a broader set of services that are relevant to health, but strictly speaking outside the quote healthcare silo. So those of you who are working on payment reform, huge opportunity, huge challenge, but I think those are the two things that I would call out of this discussion so far. So questions, sir, at the second table.
Hi, my name is Dr. Adam Brown. I am an emergency physician, I'm a clinician. I'm also department chairman of emergency medicine at United Medical Center, which is DC's publicly funded hospital, only publicly funded hospital. I'm also systems chair of a hospital in Northern Virginia for the emergency department. I bring that up because I see two very different patient populations in these two different clinical settings. The one here in DC is predominantly African American, lower socioeconomic level with really high instances of HIV, et cetera, and a lot of other conditions like asthma. In the other, we see a completely different set of conditions. One of the things that I have seen that's somewhat absent from this is what is the role that we are going to take on as clinicians and as policymakers, et cetera, to ensure that the patient has some skin in the game. Now, we have that on the side for private health insurance, but what are we doing on the side of Medicaid? And I'm kind of cautious in saying this because I know that there are concerns for creating a skin in the game philosophy for people who can't pay sometimes for food. But what do you do, or what type of incentives can we have for those type of individuals who are can't pay for their house, can't pay for their food, but are clearly driving health care?
So again, just for those who may not have been able to hear, those not in the room, the very short form of the question is how do we engage patients, that is, put skin in the game on the patient side, given the critical role of the patient in solving the problems that need to be solved? So who'd like to swing at that?
Since I have the mic, I'm going to jump in.
You have the mic, and you're the incentive, payment incentive person, so.
You know, the issues that we see with the Medicaid population is often very different than with the private population. There's a lot of concern among private plans have a lot of concern about people utilizing services. In Medicaid, we generally are more concerned about families not taking advantage of the preventive services that would be beneficial. And I think the skin in the game, if you use that term, is you have a kid waking up not breathing in the middle of the night. That's a pretty powerful incentive.
I would just add, I think the need to have all of your payers recognizing what needs to happen so that there is enough resource and enough support that change does happen. In our patient-centered medical home, we require next-day appointments and 24/7 access. So the emergency room physician can call the clinic instead of hospitalized and say, I need to see you to see this kid first thing tomorrow morning to see if we've stabilized an asthmatic crisis. So it's having everything aligned for the best outcome for the individual.
And I would just add that most of my patients who are on Medicaid have their skin in the game. And their skin in the game is that the mythology is that folks on Medicaid aren't working. And I got to say, most of my Medicaid patients are working. So when their kid's asthma isn't controlled, they're missing work. One of the reasons they go to the emergency room, frankly, is that I'm not open at night. And they're working. And if they take time off from work, they lose money. And for them to lose money is a lot worse than when I lose money, because a dollar means a lot more to them. So their incentive to go to night clinics is much greater than someone who's working in a good paying job. We're taking a day where you have sick leave and we're taking time off isn't such a big deal. So I think we need to be very careful when we're thinking about this, because you have to remember the environment that folks are living in and recognize that the incentives that we set up, one incentive isn't going to work for all populations because the fabric they're living in is different. And whatever incentives you build have to reflect that fabric going forward. I do think we need to have incentives, as you say, to drive people to the right care at the right time for the right thing. And I think they need to be nuanced and very carefully constructed.
So last comment on this point.
So I also want to make a point that you want to tailor your interventions to the population that you're serving. So you don't want to do an intensive home visiting program for a population that doesn't have the hospitalizations that warrant such an intensive program. You want to have more medical asthma education in the medical home and at the subspecialist's office and working with the families around care coordination. So you want to be choosy in terms of how you want to set up the program that makes sense for that population.
Questions, Megan?
I have a question from Twitter from AirNYC. Could one of the speakers please address the benefits for managed care providers to engage community asthma services?
I'll take that. I mean, in the silence of others. I think we are moving towards clinical providers, whether in a fully integrated ACO managed care model or in our patient-centered medical homes, to have more financial risk for the outcomes. And I think if you had a severe asthmatic that was having frequent problems, then I think it will be worth it for the financial institution that has those financial incentives to consider investing in external community-based resources, whether it's a home program that was discussed earlier or other community outreach programs. It's a risk. It's a risk stratification so that you put the most resources into the sickest patients. But I think you will see clinical leaders looking for solutions to problems that they cannot solve inside of the four walls of their clinic.
The question, can you repeat it again? What is the
Right. It's around creating incentives for managed care providers to engage community organizations.
I want to be clear that we all want the right thing for the patients. We want patients to be healthier. We don't want them missing school, families missing work, having a poor quality of life. So we all want the right things for the patients. The question is how to best deliver that and how to have some reimbursement to do that. Even if the reimbursement is only a fraction of the cost, this may not be a situation where the hospitals or the providers have financial incentives. So that's why I was a little bit stunned by the question, because it doesn't come back to the provider per se. It comes back to the team to try to support the team that may also need other resources for money even just to exist. So we all want kids to be healthy.
So I also wanted to add that within a global budget or a capitated budget, that different entities may have different needs in their community and they may see different opportunities. So if you have a handful of patients, for example, in your community who have severe asthma and require remediation, but it's not enough to support a community health worker on your staff, you might partner with other outside agencies or services to provide to address the need. Where in a different scenario, if you have a very large population of patients, it may make more sense to create it on your own.
And even if you have enough money to hire your own community health worker, if you serve patient populations that come from very different ethnic backgrounds and speak different languages, have different cultures, it may still be advantageous to contract with a community service organization that can provide service workers that can reach out to each of those ethnic groups separately.
So I'm going to take two more questions. I'll ask that the questions please be questions. Sir, in the back.
Kevin Brennan, Fagri BD Consulting, also a father of a son with asthma. I'm just curious, in talking about sort of quality of care and outcomes and looking at cost, is there enough focus being done on testing for allergies? I'm curious in that my son's condition, we sort of have kind of kicked around whether he's got a high level of allergy or not, and we're trying to figure out whether he's going to outgrow it. And it seems to me when I'm in these situations, there's a lot of discussion around sort of an assumption that we know what the allergy is and we're going to go after it. But are we not focusing enough on that? And is there an opportunity there for cost savings and better outcomes if we know a little more about if we're doing the testing and what the testing means and educating parents and others and how to, you know, address the results of those tests?
So to put that in the context of some of the targeting work, I think the question is, can we use allergy testing to help target our interventions more effectively, more efficiently?
So yes, it is very helpful to know what your young person is allergic to, because then you can focus more strongly on those triggers that impact that young person. However, there is lots of evidence nationally that approaching a child with poorly controlled asthma using a comprehensive approach, both of education, environmental assessment, and working in terms of understanding medications work. And then it's sort of the next layer to do the allergy testing to then better focus for that child on the things that make the biggest difference.
So last question.
One more thing to that? And that's, again, gets to this issue of how we as Americans think about testing. The idea is that testing is easy and gives us an answer. And part of the problem with allergy testing is neither easy and nor does it always give us an answer. And so I think we have to take the fact that factor into account as we're doing what you just said.
Jennifer Foltz, I'm a CDC Brookings Experience Fellow. We've been talking about collaborating across the team, so the pediatricians or the providers and out to counseling and then upstream community health care workers going out to that to the houses and doing environmental or public health prevention. How about collaborating across conditions? Or it used to be that the nurse could go out to a home and see the patient having, you know, needing to do remediation. You also do the lead testing and all that. So are there lessons learned, or in the new payment systems, how can you go across systems and does that improve our ROI?
I think we all have to think about that, but it's not quite as easy as it sounds. In terms of training community health workers to work with asthma, it takes a tremendous amount of training. We started out with a primarily nurse model with some community health worker involvement and have shifted to a more cost-effective community health worker model with nurse supervision. It takes a tremendous amount of nurse supervision and training to bring the community health workers to a point where they can handle the medications for children who are in the intensive care unit. I mean, we're not talking the simple, you know, everyday kind of solutions. And so you have to decide what combines well with that. Asthma nationwide is 10% of the population. So you've got lots of work to do for the patients with asthma. You might want to train other nurses and community health workers to work in terms of diabetes or cardiovascular risk factors. It might not be the same people. But having said that, when I listen to our community health workers, there's a tremendous amount of what they've done helps people not just around asthma, but around their whole life, accessing primary care, accessing mental health services, addressing both behavioral and medical issues. So I say that, but they are doing a much more comprehensive approach than just focusing on one disease.
Hey, well, one of the ways to sort of address this is through more data. So for example, currently they're through asthma inhalers, some of them have a GPS chip implanted in them. So you can, as a health system or provider, look at a heat map and see exactly where in your geography all the major hotspots of asthma are, because that's where the inhalers are being used. Now imagine then if you overlay that with where are your claims for attention deficit disorder in children? Where are your claims for major depressive problems in children? So I think part of it is using this data in a way that then informs your thought process. So just as what Liz is saying, let's say we find these geographic hotspots where we have kids who have developmental problems, they have breathing issues, they potentially, you overlay that with claims of their parents, maybe they have uncontrolled diabetes, and it informs in this particular locality, where are the needs? And then you can say, well, look, what works in downtown Baltimore may be very different than what works in Bozeman, Montana, may be very different than what we need in Miami, Florida. But then once we create those incentives to give you that information, the idea is just like politics being local, healthcare is also local, but let's be smart about it.
So David,
I think your question, how do you get it across conditions, the change? And while we're focused on asthma here today, and in any pediatric practice, asthma is going to be probably one of the major chronic conditions of treatment. In our payment effort, we have 15 different episodes. Two of them, URI and attention deficit disorder that would also affect kids, and then a lot that would address adults. We need a system transformation, not just a disease-specific change in management. We need a system-wide transformation that actually has the quarterback in place across whatever condition the child or the family has.
Yeah, and I was just going to say it was interesting because we've all heard your question differently. That I was thinking about the most common condition in childhood, which is actually behavioral health conditions, as asthma is actually second. There's a growing interest in the interaction between those two things. The idea if we can manage behavioral health issues better, because a certain number of kids have both. Actually, I know many kids who have both. And the idea if we manage their behavioral health conditions better, we will also improve their asthma care is one that we've all thought about, but the evidence isn't there yet. So I think we really need to focus on that. And the geographic thing is very cool. The folks in Cincinnati would be fun to have at one of these because they've done some really interesting stuff, geocoding the stuff around their hospital and actually showing that a very targeted intervention on a specific landlord changed their ER utilization rates.
So I'm going to turn this back to Steve to bring us to the finish line. But before I do, just a couple of quick comments from my perspective, the moderator's perspective. So what I heard very clearly from probably three or four or five speakers, and maybe not from the others because they'd heard it three or four or five times before, is that we know how to improve care for people with asthma. We have the evidence, we have the science. The problem is that science is not being institutionalized, is not being delivered consistently and reliably. And what we need, the problem that we're trying to solve is, how do we organize a system that makes it possible to do the right thing every time, consistently, reliably, and cost effectively? And the things that are critical to making that happen, what I heard were two. Physicians need to be, clinical leaders need to be involved in the design and in the execution of that system. That clinical leadership here is profoundly important. But that we also have to have a payment system that encourages and supports our systems thinking here. So With that, thank you for your questions. Thank you for the opportunity to add a couple of comments in the form of questions. And Steve, I'll let you wrap things up.
So thank you, everyone, for joining us today. And for those of you who joined us live in person and also for those on the web, if you would like to learn more about this case study, there'll be a white paper forthcoming as well as publications in the peer-reviewed literature as well. We also invite you to join us for our the remainder of our series around payment reform and healthcare. Thank you so much for your time today.